So let's talk about the current health crisis and why we should see it as a very strong motivation to spread to the solar system as fast as possible. Then of course we want to talk about the progress of Starship and Elon's already now legendary reaction to the explosion of SN1.
Then SpaceX wants to fly private astronauts to the ISS in 2021. And the 50th Falcon 9 booster successfully landed after delivering the cargo Dragon to the ISS. And it's rant time again! The NASA Chief of Human Spaceflight calls the Boeing Starliner mission a close call. And NASA suggests 61 corrective actions, but still isn't sure if they should let Boeing repeat their uncrewed Starliner test flight. And to make us even more angry, the Artemis I mission is now of course postponed to the end of 2021. What a surprise! At least Blue Origin seems to make some progress, showing us the first piece of their new Glenn rocket.
And then some interesting space news. There might be a new candidate for dark matter, and we also have discovered the first extraterrestrial protein on a meteorite. Rest in peace, rare earth theory. A lot of stuff happening in space as always, so stay tuned.
Let's begin with the current virus crisis. Now you might ask, but this is a space-oriented channel. What does a virus have to do with spaceflight? Well, simple. We often said in our older videos that there are many scenarios that can completely wipe out humanity, or if not wipe us out, then make us end up like this here. Very high on the list is a Yellowstone supervolcano eruption, a strong gamma ray burst hitting Earth, a large asteroid hitting Earth, and of course a deadly supervirus. Now the last one we are currently impressively demonstrated is a real possibility. This time we will still be lucky, but we should see it as a warning, because the next virus might be much more aggressive. This should be a strong motivation for us to build large cities on the moon and on Mars as soon as possible, so that we live on three worlds instead of one. It's funny that many people still bring forth this BS argument. Why should we invest so much money in spaceflight while we still have so many problems here on Earth? Well, look, now you see firsthand why. Because if stuff should really go bad on Earth, there would be many people living on the moon and on Mars, which not only might be able to help, but should things go really bad, carry on the legacy of humanity, then humanity wouldn't be wiped out even in the worst case scenario. And that should be highly motivating for us to get our act together and to work really hard to make humanity a multi-world species. Fortunately, there are already some people doing exactly that, working like absolute berserks to really make this goal happen. So of course we are talking about those heroes working at Boca Chica. Yes, you, dear sirs and madams, are heroes of humanity. And let's take a look at the developments at Boca Chica.
So we of course know that the Starship SN1 prototype went boom on the 28th of February. We've all seen these shots here by now. And we speculated in our last space video that the most likely cause for the failure were weak points in the welding. This was now confirmed by Elon Musk. He said that the welding was weak at two points in the lower part of SN1, not being able to withstand the pressure at those cryogenic temperatures. And it appears that our boy Elon was not so amused by that. Ars Technica recently published a highly interesting article, link in the description, on Elon's reaction. And let us tell you, it is legendary. He addressed the Starship team and said that if anyone had a doubt about the quality of any part of a Starship prototype, he or she should address Elon directly. Not the immediate superior, no, Elon directly. Now this is what we call a business structure with very short communication lines. Every person can directly write the CEO an email and he will listen and act accordingly. Amazing! So he said that from now on, every single worker should treat any Starship prototype as being their baby. And that means that they should really ensure that every part, every bolt, and every weld of Starship meets the highest quality standards. This insane level of dedication and also the insane level of technical knowledge of Elon Musk is exactly the reason why SpaceX is so successful. No one else comes even close. So of course now the SN2 prototype is coming together nicely and is set to continue where SN1 failed. We can see in these shots how the first test tank is already finished and carried to the test site, where it will undergo pressurization tests. First with water and then at cryogenic temperatures with liquefied nitrogen. Now we have to say that this test tank looks already much higher quality than the SN1 test tank and the SN1 itself. The welds and steel rings look much better. Meanwhile, the other things are also going extremely well for SpaceX. Starlink, for example, is growing with an average of one Starlink launch every 2 weeks. The next one being set already for the 14th of March with the Starlink 5 mission, upping the number of Starlink satellites to 300. This is looking excellent for North America coverage at the latest by the end of the year. And we all know that Starlink will be SpaceX's cash cow.
Then a Falcon 9 booster performed the 50th successful landing after delivering the cargo Dragon for the last time to the ISS. The next resupply missions will be using the new updated cargo Dragon capsule. Then we already talked about that SpaceX will probably send up to 4 private individuals on an Earth round trip with Crew Dragon in late 2021 or early 2022 in cooperation with the company Space Adventures. And now we have another announcement of sending 3 private astronauts to the ISS for 10 days in 2021 in cooperation with the Houston-based startup Axiom Space. We really like that SpaceX is increasingly embracing the young space tourism industry, which will create a nice additional income stream on top of the regular launch contracts and on top of the Starlink revenue. Gigantic new income streams wherever we look. So while everything is going really nicely for SpaceX, what are the others doing meanwhile?
Well, Blue Origin for one has really shown us the first piece of its future new Glenn rocket. And which piece is it? Is it a pressure test article? Is it the first stage with attached BE-4 engines? Is it the second stage with attached BE-3U engines? It is a payload fairing. Okay, better than nothing, we guess. You know, this feels a bit like a car maker announcing this amazing new electric hypercar, which will be so awesome, and then showing us a portion of the front trunk as a teaser. So while SpaceX is building a complete assembly line to pump out hundreds of Starships, Blue Origin shows us a payload fairing. One payload fairing. Okay. Now we just hope we will soon see a bit more than that, else we still will doubt that the new Glenn will actually fly by 2021. Now we strongly believe on this channel that the new Glenn will fly best case, and this is absolutely best case, by 2023, mark our words. Well, but we shouldn't be too harsh with them, because they probably still will be faster than Boeing.
Talking of Boeing, NASA has released an updated statement on the Starliner test flight from last December, of which we already talked quite a few times. Because so many things went wrong with this flight, that it's not even funny anymore. We talked about it in detail, for example, in this video here. Now NASA has newly identified 61 corrective actions. Yes, you heard that right, 61 corrective actions, which Boeing has to take in order to fix all the issues with Starliner. 61! Douglas Lovera, the chief of human spaceflight at NASA, even goes as far as to call the Starliner test flight a high visibility close call. And how do you think NASA reacted now? Normally, of course, a second uncrewed test flight should be a total no-brainer. Absolute no-brainer. But no, instead Lovera said, quite frankly, right now we don't know. They have to now come back to NASA with a plan how they are going to go ahead and address all of those recommendations. We will do our own inspection of the results of their work, and then we will be in a position to decide whether or not we need another uncrewed test flight or not. Seriously? 61 corrective actions? 61 and still not sure if another uncrewed test flight is needed? If SpaceX would have only needed 6 instead of 61 corrective actions, NASA would certainly have SpaceX perform another uncrewed test flight. even considering to send astronauts to the ISS with Starliner on the next flight, is pure madness. Boeing is really doing a great job paying off all those NASA people. Lobbying? Nah. Corruption at its finest, we guess. At least one area where Boeing excels. This just stinks and makes us angry. All because of lobbyism, favoritism, nepotism, and all that crap. We can't stand it anymore. It makes us...
Sorry for that one, but the favoritism towards Boeing makes us so angry. Now fortunately, SpaceX will still launch astronauts to the ISS before Boeing with Crew Dragon in May with an extremely high likelihood. If not, we will go absolutely berserk. But hey, don't worry, because over at Artemis, everything is looking absolutely perfect. That is, in a parallel reality. Not in ours, because in our reality, Artemis 1 has been pushed back to the second half of 2021. What a surprise, we really didn't see that one coming, did we? And we all know what second half means, okay? That certainly will not be the 1st of July 2021, but more likely the end of December 2021. And if it's already the end of December 2021, then it will certainly be early 2022. And if it's already early 2022, it will be late 2022, and so on and so forth. So just as a recap, Artemis 1 would have foreseen an uncrewed test flight of the SLS Block 1, that is, the first iteration of the SLS rocket, complete with the Orion space capsule. The Orion capsule would have been sent on a round trip around the moon, while the SLS would have, of course, been completely thrown away in good old 60s fashion. Now that mission was initially set for late this year, but now of course it's just being postponed. That's what we've been saying on this channel all the time. They actually don't want the SLS to fly. The SLS, which normally stands for Space Launch System, but let's be realistic here, it actually stands for Senate Launch System, is not really meant to fly. That's why all these missions involving SLS will just keep getting postponed. Because ultimately, the SLS is just a giant job creation program for companies like Boeing, Lockheed, and Northrop. First and foremost, Boeing, of course. It's about securing jobs in Alabama and other states, and senators wielding the power in Congress are making sure that SLS will keep getting postponed indefinitely, so that these jobs can just be kept indefinitely. Now that strategy, although ridiculously obvious, worked very fine until now. But SpaceX will show them that this strategy will be really, really bad very, very soon. You cannot stop disruption, even with lobbying and corruption, you can only postpone the inevitable. But we shouldn't rant too much, or else we see the Hulk a second time. And similar to Cato in the Senate of Rome, we shall finish this section here with the words: furthermore, we think that SLS has to be cancelled. Oh, and Starship will land on the moon long before NASA.
In other space news, a new potential candidate for dark matter has been proposed. We already talked about dark energy in one of our videos, which you can watch right here, where we explain our stance that we believe dark energy is merely an illusion. However, dark matter is different. Many observations, for example from far away galaxies, show that dark matter must indeed exist, because some galaxies have dark matter, whereas others don't. This observation would not exist if dark matter was just an apparent effect, resulting from a modified form of gravity. Now a new candidate for dark matter has been proposed, a particle consisting of 6 quarks, with the cool name D-star hexaquark. Normal matter, protons and neutrons, is built of 3 quarks. The exotic 6-quark particle would have been formed early during the Big Bang and could be stable for long periods of time in form of Bose-Einstein condensates. This is a highly interesting form of matter in which many bosons, these are particles with integer spin, can band together and form a condensate, in which they all behave as if they were one giant superparticle. Yes, the world of quantum mechanics is highly weird. In any case, we will keep a close eye on the development on the true nature of dark matter, and also on the development regarding dark energy, of course.
And now to a discovery which proponents of the so-called rare Earth theory will certainly dislike a lot. You know, the theory that Earth is so rare and special, and that also we humans are so very, very special. Yeah, right, humanity. Getting disappointed about our specialness since hundreds of years now. We're not in the center of the universe, not even the center of the solar system, not even in the center of the galaxy, not even in the center of anything anymore. But hey, this time we certainly will be special, because life only arrived here on Earth and nowhere else. This was a one-time event in cosmic history, and so extremely unlikely that we certainly are alone in the universe. Dream on, rare earthers, dream on! In reality, not only have complex amino acids, and not long ago even sugar molecules been discovered on meteorites, but no, now even the first protein of non-Earth origin, meaning it has formed in deep space, has been discovered on a meteorite which fell to Earth 30 years ago. A team of scientists recently analyzed a meteorite which landed in Algeria in 1990. High-precision mass spectroscopy revealed the presence of a novel protein, which the researchers proposed calling hemolithin. It consists of chains of the amino acids glycine and hydroxyglycine, as well as iron, oxygen, and lithium atoms.
But what's really interesting is that hemolithin is significantly enriched in deuterium, a heavy isotope of hydrogen, consisting of a neutron and a proton in its core. Now, such deuterium enrichment does not appear in amino acids that form on Earth, and so it must have formed somewhere else in the solar system, in the solar clouds during the early days of its formation. Complex proteins forming by themselves in space is huge news, and really means that the building blocks of life occur naturally everywhere in the universe. That also explains why life started so fast on Earth, even though the conditions on early Earth were extremely hostile to life. The building blocks for life are everywhere in the universe. And as soon as those proteins find a host planet with the right temperature and with water, of which there are billions in the galaxy, life begins immediately afterwards. No magic intervention needed, and no extremely unlikely odds. We have been saying all the time that the universe is really full of life, and this is another piece of the puzzle confirming our view.
So do you agree with us that the current virus crisis shows us impressively that it is important to spread to the solar system as fast as possible?
And do you agree with us that NASA is much too friendly to Boeing again, despite their insane failures? We'd really like to know your thoughts in the comment section.
So you just watched the JS Space Report, the commentary show on every Monday, where we talk about interesting events in spaceflight and space exploration with a strong emphasis on space politics.
So thanks for watching, and I would say, on to the future! On! Ha 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 ha